time I can really play games with any one man is on the weekend. That's it. And I have to really kind of choose what I want to play.
Uh-huh.
And I've been in a real competitive mood lately. I do want to talk about that, too. Like, I've been really wanting to play competitive games. What's that look for?
Nothing.
I didn't play the game that I picked. I downloaded it. I definitely downloaded it, and then I saw like gameplay, and it's like a very like kind of like slow like puzzle based game, and it's like very story driven. I was like, okay, that looks kind of cool, but then
that's
a perfect
game for work that you don't need to play online, huh? Interesting.
Well, there was another game that I actually found on Games Pass that I've been looking at for a couple years. And I finally downloaded it and started playing it, and I've been playing that a lot. It's on Games Pass as well. That's my fault. That's my bad. But I know you and I, for your game, we definitely need to play that co-op.
I played it, and it seems, well, I'll get into it later, but it just seems like that you have to play a co-op because there's support characters and all that, and me running around by myself.
The gameplay's
fine and good. I mean, I've only seen two enemies, but I've played I can't get past the first level. So
No. That game, yeah, you need an actual squad or at least one other player.
Yeah, something. But maybe me and Corey will play it since you recommend a co-op game with me and then never play with me. So that's good.
First of all, you're always playing Sea of Thieves. You don't play any other game but Sea of Thieves. You'll fuck yourself.
I play MLB The Show. I play NBA 2K. I played I beat Ori in the Blind Forest, a game that you recommended, and you won't even play. You can't play online with us. So then you... What?
Yeah, have you noticed that
I... all my stuff.
I didn't break anything.
How is that not broken?
Have you noticed how I don't... Whenever I'm at work, I don't play an online game. It's always a game that's like a storyline.
A single player game, yeah.
Yeah. So I can't, man. Like, it doesn't even matter if my hotspot, if I get more data back or whatnot. It doesn't matter.
What's your excuse for not playing the single player game that you had to do?
Because I looked at the gameplay and I didn't want to play it. I'll try it out. But I was like, I don't know where I want to play that.
There are games. That's the whole point of this, Ray, is to play a game that you don't normally play.
First of all, I'm like one of the only ones that actually branches out and goes and plays other games. Okay, so I don't want to fucking hear it. I don't want to hear it. You play the same damn game all the time. You would have never played Ori unless it was for me, even though this whole thing was your idea.
Yeah. So yeah, credit to myself.
But you don't like to play other games. Okay. You would have probably never played Control.
I mean, it's a kind of game I like, but I don't know if I would have seen the advertisement and then
so don't tell me this is the point of the game. I know that's the point. Okay, it's just one of those games.
So you have no excuse why you didn't play the single player game for the whole last week at all. I'm just out for an hour or two. Just to
I know.
Try
I
out
even
and
downloaded
like
it. I even downloaded it too. I downloaded like the second day. I was like,
and it's not a big file. You can't do the. I can't download it.
No, man. If I try to download something, even just like a regular megabyte update, man. Like I remember, I was I think it was like a week and a half ago. I was at work, and I brought my Xbox and I turned it on, and it said that it needed a system update. And it was like I don't know, like I think it was like 700 megabytes. It took like 45 minutes.
What work? Right? At work.
Yeah, on my fucking hotspot. I'm like, and I couldn't turn it off. I couldn't turn it off because I'll fuck shit up. I would have fucked things up.
You need to turn it on.
I know. I need to plug it in and turn it on. When I'm at home.
Yeah, you bought a console that you don't play very often.
What are you talking about? I play it all the time.
No, you don't. If it's not updated.
What are you talking about? I keep it in my bag and I take it at work every single day. You retard. Every day. Okay. You know what? All right, motherfucker.
Okay. So.
Okay.
Just. Okay. And don't forget to download Sea of Thieves while you're at it, you prick.
Look, this right here, I bought this fucking thing, okay? So I could store it better.
Let all the thieves know what you got in that bag. Hey, if you're going to steal something, it's the next game.
All right, so I keep this. It's in here right now, all right? I keep it in here so then I don't have to fucking store it. Especially when we do our podcast, so then I could just get up and go.
Oh, yeah, that's your go bag?
Yes. Yeah. Hello. Yeah. What else?
I never said you didn't bring it to work. I never said that. You said you wanted to show off your little Xbox bag that you got. That's all that
was. It's really neat. It was like $60 on Amazon. It's I'm getting it. Because the bag that I put it in was too big, and it would, like, move around all over the place, and I didn't like that.
You need it secure. You need it secure. So it doesn't mess up.
My investment. Secure your mother.
We'll see. I'll give it a few more tries, and then if, you know, my friend who tells me to play it doesn't.
I mean, we could try to play Sega Extinction tonight. We could try that. I could just try it and see if it's not as laggy as it usually is. Maybe we could play like a round or two.
Yeah, that'd be nice.
Because I have it downloaded. Sega Extinction. I have it downloaded.
Okay, well, you should download Sea of Thieves, but neither here nor there. That's neither here nor there.
All right. Look, hey, okay. I'll bring my Xbox this weekend, and we'll play Sea of Thieves.
Just try it out. Well, you're gonna need. We don't have a monitor.
I can bring a monitor.
I like how you have to drive. I like how driving all the way down here to play Sea of Thieves is less of a problem than just plugging it into your console, the where you're at right now currently. I like how that is a thing, but that's fine.
No, I'm saying like, okay, all right, fine. Okay, you guys really want me to play Sea of Thieves with you? All right, I'm giving in. Yeah. All right.
Just download it onto the console and then just try it out and see. You don't know.
I've played the game before. I played it on console before. I know.
So when you're at work and you don't have anything to do, me and Corey are on for 2 or 3 hours most nights playing Sea of Thieves. Having fun, just messing around.
We'll try Second Extinction tonight.
I'm not asking to play every night. Once a week, is that a problem to my friend? Once a week, Jesus Christ!
Yeah. Hey, at least I come down and hang out with you now. All right.
You do that so you get away from Apple Valley, so I don't want to the desert.
First of all, I'm in Adelanto.
Oh, okay.
And secondly, San Diego is very liberal. Okay,
it's the same thing, but it's nice though.
Yeah.
It's not like you're going out and talking to everybody, and people are mostly conservative inside.
No,
inside.
They get home, they're like, we don't really believe this shit that we.
No, we don't. We don't really.
We would actually like to have them over for barbecue because they're like the conservatives, like the funnest people, because they don't take everything wrong
way too seriously. Okay, well, hello everybody. This is another episode of the Video Games and Nonsense Podcast. I'm one of your hosts, Chase Carter, and that's
Ray Woods.
Ray Woods now. Again, whatever. This is where we talk about video games and nonsense, what we've been playing. So, Ray, what have you been playing lately besides the game that we decided you would play this week?
So, as you saw, I've been playing a lot more Call of Duty, and then I started playing Cold War. Dude, look, I got to hand it to Call of Duty, okay?
The game that you said you'd never play again? Okay, go ahead. I was right.
Look, man, none of my friends play any other competitive games at all. They don't play Apex. They don't play Rogue Company anymore.
Sea of Thieves is competitive.
It's not a competitive game. It's not a competitive game.
You fight each other.
No. Because when me and Dylan and our buddy Fire, when they were playing Rogue Company, I played that, and I love that game. I love Rogue Company because we usually win. And then they stopped playing that. And so, like I said, I got into a competitive mood because I started playing Apex again, and no one wants to play that, so I can't play that. So I'm like, okay, well, fuck it. Fine. Fuck it. I'll just fucking play Call of Duty. I mean, sometimes I have fun, but the whole – dude, I got to hand it to Activision and Infinity Ward and Treyarch or whoever. So what they did is with Cold War, you can use guns in Cold War in Warzone. But the only way to actually upgrade and be able to customize the guns – and there's a lot of guns in Cold War that fucking shred in Warzone. The only way to use the guns in Cold War – that are in Cold War in Warzone, you have to play Cold War, and you have to play them and upgrade the guns and unlock them, and then put the attack and unlock them, and then you can in Warzone, because they're all connected, they're all like cross play and cross save and all that. So that's why I was like, I'm sitting here, I'm like, in Warzone, if you want to have a good time and actually get kills, you have to use the more meta weapons, as they say. So I said, okay, you know what, fine, I'll fucking download it. So I play it to upgrade these guns. And, you know, I kind of have to grin and bear it because, like, there's no one else wants to play any other fucking competitive multiplayer games, which is fucking annoying. Like, if we wanted to play Battlefield, I'd play that more. Like I said, like, I have to kind of just grin and bear it. And I can't even play with them. I only can play with them on the weekend. Like, I would play Second Extinction. I would play, because me, you, Dylan, and Ricky, we could all play Second Extinction. But Dylan keeps giving me the bullshit excuse, oh, it's not downloaded. It's not downloaded. I said,
but
dude,
why don't you just find people that go on forums, go on...
I know. I should do that. I don't know.
I don't understand why your video game life revolves around what video games Dylan's playing.
No, it's not just Dylan, you idiot.
Or Fire, Dylan and his one or two family members.
Yeah, that's all who play... Those are the only people I know that play competitive multiplayer games. You don't play them anymore.
Well, like, I'll play Battlefield with you. I re-downloaded it just for you, and then we played it once, and then hey, do you want to play Battlefield tonight? Nothing. So the only person that wants to play games with me is my girlfriend, and she keeps bringing up Sea of Thieves every day. So that's the only thing I'm like, okay, cool. Yeah, I have someone that I can play games with. It's a fun game, and just the co-op experience and hanging out, and that game is fun. And I like Sea of Thieves because you can have action, can have basically as much action as you want. So you can fight, PvPing, but if you just want to hang out, be goofy, you can do that too. So I like the contrast. It's not always just go to battle, take over this area, and then move on to the next one, then lose that area, then go back. Like that's still fun, but I do like the...
First of all, there's more to Battlefield.
Well, no, you kill people and you take over an area. That's what you do in Battlefield. That's what you do. Jesus.
That's the premise of the game mode.
Well, I understand that. Battlefield. That's pretty much Battlefield. And you made yourself blurry. Oh, wait, no, they fixed it. Okay. But yeah, but that's what I'm saying. It's a different, there's more to do, I would say, or different styles of play in Sea of Thieves. Sea of Thieves is more of a, like, kind of play how you want. There's no, like, calm way to play Battlefield.
Well, you don't play Battlefield to have a calm. You don't play Battlefield to be calm.
Well, I understand that, but the contrast is what interests me in games, and I've been thinking about this lately. Why are games only one type of game? You know what I mean? Like it's like a survival game. It's a first person shooter game, kill, take over things. It's either a PvE world. Like, why not have kind of how Halo did it, to where like you have a multiplayer match, but then there's computer AI in the game that you can go take care of and do a mission if you don't want to go PvP. But like in a big world, like in a big open world, just have different forms of it. And like say like the Division, but have your if you wanted to do PvP, you would go into the Dark Zone.
There's actually a game out it's in early release. It's called Scavengers, and it's literally exactly what you were saying. So there's a PvE aspect. Now you eventually do get forced into PvP. I mean, I guess that's kind of how sometimes that's how Sea of Thieves is. Like, because if you have another team and they start attacking you, you're basically forced into PvP.
Yeah.
But with Scavengers, that's how it is too. But the majority of it is PvE, and you go and scavenge around. You get, you know, it's third person. You have these characters with different abilities. And you get different weapons and stuff like that. But what it is you try to get as much data as you can in the game, and you get it by, you know, by certain doing certain objectives and killing enemies and stuff like that. But there's other teams around, and it's a huge, huge map. And then there's these storms. It's really, really cool. There's these storms that'll come around, and you have to take shelter. And if you don't, you can take damage. And then like there's like these really like it's like usually it's really cold. And you could take cold damage. You'll see your health. Like there'll be like ice on your health. And then you have to like warm yourself by a fire. And you also have to eat food. So it's like a survival kind of it's like a survival PvP,
like shared
PvE,
world experience. Yeah.
Third person shooter world. Yeah, it's really interesting. But it's got like different levels of loot tier okay. loot. And there's a crafting mechanic, but then the gunfights it feels really good, like really, really good. It's really satisfying. Like you can get a bow, and like the AI, when you shoot him and you hit him in the head, you're like, that was really cool. It's really satisfying. Really, really. And then it switches because, like I said, the map is so big, and you'll see in the top right, it'll show who's in first place with and that's based off of how much data each team has. And then, like I said, eventually you could go the entire game without meeting any PvP. And then there's a dropship that comes, and everyone has to get there. And that's where it's like mostly forced. But if you get in that's how you basically, you know, that's how you secure all of your data and all of your, you know, material that you get, so you can craft more and stuff like that. But it's in early access right now. It's really, really cool. I've been wanting to play that a lot more with Dylan and Ricky and all them. But they don't want to do that. They want to play fucking Modern Warfare. Like I said, if you're in a competitive mood and you don't – like, I get – yeah, I should probably go on forums and stuff like that. But I don't know. Like, because I like to – especially with Dylan, like, I like to go into, like, a Apex or Call of Duty and have fun and, you know, joke around with my friends. I don't want to have to – like, I guess I could just meet new people and whatnot. But
– yeah, that's – Corey, because I wasn't playing Sea of Thieves with her for, like, a week. And then – so she went on Discord. She found out what Discord was. Went on there, and she has a – it's not a clan. It's not a group. It's – they call themselves a cabal.
Ooh, okay.
And they're a cabal of Sea of Thieves players. And in the Discord, they have ranks of – they have their own ranks. So, like, you cannot captain your own ship unless you reach the rank of captain.
That's kind of cool.
So. On the thing. Yeah, yeah.
So they're, like, real, like, role-playing, yeah.
No, they're really into it. And you have to earn a certain amount of gold every month or every week or something like that. And there are people who keep track of it, your gold. The gold that you – and I'm just like
– yeah, Discord's really cool. That's usually – she probably downloaded it on her phone, though, because you can have it on your phone as well.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And then so that, like, that got me thinking. I was like, oh, and so if I wanted to play a game, a co-op game with somebody, and I really wanted to, like, sit you with Battlefield, if you just wanted to play Battlefield, there are people out there who take Battlefield seriously and are, you know, ex-military people that, you know, like to joke around or whatever, and they just like, and they have certain roles and all of that stuff. So I don't know why you're.
Yeah, I'll probably just start doing that.
Yeah, you're playing a game you don't really want to play just because hanging out with your friends is fun. But that's like – it's the same thing as going to a bar to hang out with your friends. Like, you may not like going to a bar or to a club, but your friends are there. So that's why you're going to hang out and have fun. But you don't have to do something that you kind of don't enjoy doing. Now, Call of Duty isn't, you know, torture. It's still a decent, fun game to play. But, yeah, I wouldn't play a game you don't like because the majority of your friends are playing those games. I saw, do you know Gribble? I don't know who Gribble is. Is he part of Dylan's group of friends, or like Nighthawk or something? They were playing Sea of Thieves.
Nighthawk, yeah.
Yeah,
that's Jake.
Yeah, Jake, yeah. He like, I think he was playing Sea of Thieves, and I was all... okay, you guys can't play the game that I play, and then don't invite me, but they do. But it's
fine. Well, I don't think he really knows you very well. I think he, like, knows of you. He knows,
I was like, hey,
probably wasn't even paying attention.
I know. But look, okay, I'm going to, in my fantasy, in my head, he saw me playing Sea of Thieves all the time. He knew that I play Sea of Thieves. He started it just to spite me. That's in my head how it goes.
I'll start playing with you guys more, right? Okay?
You're all these excuses. You talk about Dylan and his excuses.
I've never said, oh, I can't play because I've never given you a dumbass.
You said, I can't play because at work I can't.
That's the legit, hello? Like, it's hotspot. You know that. Come on now.
So you won't even try. You've never tried.
No, I have tried. What are you talking about?
You've never tried playing Sea of Thieves at work with me. No.
Chase, it doesn't matter what online game I play. It doesn't matter. Like, okay, for instance, it was like, I think like 3 weeks ago. I was playing Outriders when like I was like, because I had gotten into one of the Technomancer class, and that class is awesome. And I was playing one of the expeditions, and I didn't realize that I didn't realize my party was open, so anyone can join. And someone joins, and I look at them, and they're literally like this. Their character is lagging. Like he's standing there, moving. And it's not him, it's me. And I'm like, oh my god, I can't even play, because I was going to play with him because he helped me out with the expedition. And I was like, I can't play. There's no point. I can't play.
But is the enemy AI like okay for you? You know what I mean? Because that's kind of all you would need, right? In that, because you're not shooting other people, you're
Well, no, yeah, no. Well, because like, cause the build that I had on the fucking on the Technomancer was really, really strong. But anyways,
That's not my question. My question is, you're dealing with lag, you said, right? It's an online game. So when was he the only one glitching for you? Like when you
no,
in the
actually,
world,
no, he was
or the AI
when he
the,
when
the
he joined
computer characters.
No, when yeah, when he joined the AI was kind of lagging as well.
Okay.
So it was the server. It's the server. It's like
I was wondering. I didn't know if it was just the human characters, your co-op characters, or the game.
Because if it was, then that could just be on his end. But I'm like, it's.
That's what I'm like. Yeah, if it's both, then it's more likely on your end. I was playing. Speaking of good games, Corey and I are playing Halo 2, the campaign, and the first level. Some of the best.
Yeah.
It's the first level in Halo 2, amazing. And then when it gets it, then you become the Arbiter. And then you go into these like small corridors. Like first level of Halo, you're on Earth, and you're going through like these back alleyways, and it feels really good. The sun's out. It feels really good as Master Chief. And then you're the Arbiter. It just ruins it. It just puts you in these small corridors, and I'm just, the gameplay, it feels great, but the contrast between being the Master Chief and the Arbiter,
when I first played Halo 2, like I love, obviously the storyline was great, but I really didn't like playing as the Arbiter. Like I'm like, this is dumb. Like this is really dumb.
It's a cool way to like for you to see into the Covenant's perspective, but I'm a human playing. Now, if you want to do a spin-off game called Halo Arbiter Journeys or whatever, Arbiter Chronicles,
Do that.
We had a Halo ODST. We had that. You're not a Spartan soldier. You're just a normal like Marine ODST guy. Yeah, like orbital dropship trooper or whatever it's called. I know exactly what it's called because I read all the books. But I was just sitting there like, why? Why?
I know. I think that's another reason why people didn't like Halo 5 is because you would switch. You constantly switch, and people are like, I want to know Master Chief. I want to be Master Chief. I don't want to be this other character. And I don't understand how companies don't get that. I don't understand that. People, this is what I understand. People love Master Chief is one of the, if not the biggest iconic game
video game
character. And you don't give him the entire screen time. Hello, hello, hello.
Do you know how hard it is to get a character to resonate?
I know. Yeah, exactly.
Like all the video game characters, there's thousands, hundreds of thousands of them that no one could care about. And you have one of the biggest ones. People love his voice, that character. They love Cortana. And then you take them away from that.
Yeah. Like, I don't
they haven't been playing that. And I can see if Halo came out every year. It was a Call of Duty kind of thing.
Yeah.
But it comes out every 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 years.
I don't get it.
It's like, well, we don't want people to get tired of playing as a Chief.
We won't!
Not if you make me game every 5 or 6 or 7 or 8 years or whatever. I'm just like, I want to play. I'm a human being. Aliens are invading. So I want to play as a human since I'm a human. I don't want to play as an alien in this game that's maybe if it started out as an alien. I don't know how I would feel about it. But I want to play the badass Master Chief character that I grew up playing the whole way through. I don't want to.
Yeah. And then even people who don't know video games, who don't play video games, they're like, when they hear Master Chief, oh yeah, that fucking Halo game.
Yeah. Like you can't, that's something I don't think you can buy. It's like if you have a Mario game and then you're not Mario.
Yeah, exactly.
You're some other character. That's why it's called Luigi's Mansion when the game comes out. Because you're Luigi.
Yeah, you're Luigi. I mean, Mario, I don't know, Mario, because there are a lot of people, they'll like Peach more or Waluigi or Wario. But even then, like still, like, a Mario game, like if you're not Mario, what is this company doing? Hello?
Yeah, what are we doing?
I get that. Yeah,
it's confusing.
It would be like playing
God of War and not being Kratos.
Yeah, God of War not being Kratos. You're like, what the fuck?
I don't. If you want to have a side character, have the co-op person be the Arbiter, and then the Chief and the Arbiter are fighting together. Because you know how like when when you're fighting, which never really made sense to me, but when you're fighting, because Master Chief was one of the last Spartans until they redid all the lore, but whatever. he when you're playing co-op, there's like a second Master Chief in the world. And yeah. I always wondered how you could do that with it making sense in the story. You know what I mean? So like, so I never, I can't wrap my head around that. But like, if you put him into a, say like your co-op character is a Marine or whatever, but then he wouldn't have the shield. He would have, he'd be something completely different. So your co-op character would have a completely different experience. But I think that, that duality would be kind of cool, because then that one player, the main character, is like a badass. And he, and that person has to, so like in me and Corey, I would be the Spartan. She would be the little Marine, and she'd have to be more careful when I can go out there and just run and gun and kill everything.
Yeah.
Or if she wanted, we can switch and we can have that kind of, that, you know, the different types of gameplay. I think that would be interesting as far as the gameplay, I don't know, mechanic or, it's the same thing as I'm thinking about, like with this, the question that I wanted to ask you, just jumping all over, around all over the place today. But our video, since video games went up to $70 with this, with the next gen, certain ones for right now anyway, I don't know, I'm assuming eventually all of them will be. I don't mind paying extra for games. Yeah. And technically it's not extra, because due to inflation, games have stayed $60 for like the past two decades or whatever it is.
Yeah.
And old Nintendo games and Super Nintendo games used to cost like $100 and something. Like way, like certain, what it would depend on the memory in the game and all this stuff.
Oh, so yeah.
It would, what it's whatever. But $70, it went up. But I'm wondering what, if we're, say we're paying, from that instance, just paying more for the same kind of open world games, what are we getting extra for the $70? Because we still have all the bugs, as more bugs now than I would say ever before, more connection issues, more game crashes. Game companies coming out promising a certain type of game and then having that game
not be there at all.
So I'm just wondering.
I would say it definitely depends. Okay, for instance, so the game Returnal for the PlayStation 5, that's a PS5 exclusive. PS5 exclusive. Not out. It doesn't come out. If you don't have a PS5, you can't play the game. As far as that's what I've been seeing. It's on PS5 exclusive, because it's in $70. Returnal, I would say, it's worth $70, because it's very difficult. You know, the story is phenomenal. The gunplay, the gameplay is amazing. There is one glitch, however. I don't know if I mentioned this. I think I might have mentioned it.
Well, I heard there's multiple, but that's...
From my experience, there's only one bug that I've experienced, and it depending on how far you are and, you know, what you have, you know, what your gear is, you know, at the moment, it can be game-breaking. The reason why I say that is because I kind of narrowed it down to what would trigger the bug. So the bug was slabs, and they have lights on them. One is like a red. It has red light, and then another one is green. And so the green one, if you go up to it and you lay on it, and it'll increase your health. And so I noticed that, and the other one was like, it would do something to your gear. I can't remember now, but it would take your health away. So I was like, I'm not doing that. But you would lay in the green slab, and you would like rest, and then your health would increase. But what would happen is that, I would wake up, and then I'd try to pick something up, an item up, and I couldn't pick it up. It wouldn't even give me the prompt because it's triangle. It wouldn't even bring up like what the fucking item was. Then I'd go to a door and try to leave, and the door wouldn't open. I would literally, the only way that I could actually fix it was reset, and it says like reset the cycle. You like in the pause menu, and I'm like, so if I'm fucking far as fuck and I have like really good gear, And that fucking bug happens, I have to reset because the game is fucked like that. And it, now, like I said, it is only triggered by, but what I notice is if you use those slabs of like that, that helps your like gear or your health. And so I was like, okay, so that's what it is. I'm not doing that. So now I avoided those, and now I haven't experienced it.
Okay.
But see, the only problem,
you shouldn't have to work around like a game.
I know.
And again, $70 for, and there's
another problem that I've been wanting to mention about Returnal is There are a lot of items in the game that I don't think the devs really thought through. Now, maybe they just did it on purpose because the game, most of the game is working against you, and I'm not even joking. Like, if you were to play the game, you'd be like, okay, this is, it's different. Now, I don't know. It seems to me like it's more of a, because I'm at a point now in that game where I can't get past it. I just can't. Doesn't matter what gear I have. The enemies are so difficult. And I can't do it. I literally can't do it. I don't know what to do. Maybe I'll have to find a run through, and watch someone do it. But so you'll get these parasites, which they'll give you some sort of buff. Like, you know, they'll give you a buff, but they'll also give you a debuff. And then you have these chests that if you open it, there's a certain like you have like a they'll give you malignant, is that that word? But and you have a chance of getting a malfunction on your suit, and what a malfunction on your suit does is say that you'll take like fall damage, because there's no fall damage in the game, but you'll take fall damage, and then you have to do certain things or get certain things to remedy that. Okay. And if you get too many malfunctions on your suit, if you have like a suit upgrade, it'll take away that suit upgrade. And you don't know that until it actually happens. And you're like, okay, that's a little, okay. And then like some malfunctions, in order to remedy certain malfunctions, there's a currency in the game. It's called obelites. It's like this yellowish white substance, like a mineral basically.
Yeah.
And like because some malfunctions, they'll be pretty bad. And the only way to remedy them is getting 300 obelites. And 300 obelites in that game is a decent amount. I mean, you know, if you can save up to get however much, but 300, that's a lot to get. You have to attack a lot of enemies because you get obelites from enemies and stuff like that. And a lot of the time too, for me, like, I mean, there's obviously, I'm not like the greatest player. But like for the fall damage, like I was in the area that I was in, and I was fighting all these enemies, and it was so difficult. I literally forgot that I had fall damage on, and so I jumped to try to get away, and I landed and took so much damage. I'm like, you gotta be fucking kidding me! Like, this is fucking like, and so like I said, it's almost like a roguelike. What is the game? Dark Souls game. And yeah. You know I don't like Dark Souls. Like, you know I don't like games to be overly difficult. To me, that is the most pointless shit ever. There's no point in that. The game has to be a certain amount of difficulty, obviously. But there's a meeting where you have a game that's difficult, but also fun. Video games are supposed to be fun. That's why I don't understand how there are people who like Dark Souls. I don't get that. I understand that the gameplay is fun. But even then, like, you watch gameplay, and it's... roll, and that's it. I'm like, I don't. That doesn't make any sense to me. That makes absolutely no sense. Like, if I could understand if like the fucking gameplay was really cool, I understand you get like upgrades and you get different armor and stuff like that. Like, that part's cool, but you're literally just swinging. Like, that's it. And then dodge, swing, roll. You get hit once, you're dead. I don't know. That's just me. Like I said, you get nothing out of the game being difficult. I've said this a million times. You get nothing out of the game being difficult other than you brag about, oh, I beat Dark Souls. Oh, so you're a fucking nerd and you do nothing else with your life. Got it. Like, that's literally it.
Well, like, I understand what you're saying. There are people who like really hard games. It's fun for them to bang their head up against a wall.
Oh, of course.
You don't understand. Like, but that's not why you want to play. You want a certain amount of difficulty where you're not just this overpowered person destroying everything, because then it doesn't mean
anything. No, yeah.
There has to be some kind of difficulty. What I like when games do is they introduce a boss or a character or a new type. You've been going through one type of character, and then you have another type that's difficult at first, and then somehow you upgrade, you beat one and it's tough, and then you get some upgrade or a weapon that takes care of that enemy. Yeah. And then that enemy is no longer difficult for you. And then another enemy gets introduced, and you're like, wait a minute, you have to figure it out.
Kind of like Metroid, how the Metroid games kind of are.
Yeah. Like, stuff like that, where you're just, the game always evolves to where it every few hours it introduces something new to you.
Yeah.
And you're like, how do I get through this? This is tough. I can't beat this. And then you're like, oh, okay. And you beat him. and then beat him or her, and then you get their weapon, and you're like, oh, okay, so and then now I can progress even further and further and further. But those are the kind of games I like, but not a lot of games do that. And that's what when we're talking about games being worth $70, I would like to see games incorporate different styles of games, so it's not just a first-person shooter the entire time. It has some survival horror elements, and then some just really quick twitch first-person shooter, high action, and then maybe some like strategic parts where you get command of an army, and that now you're looking at the world from like, you know, maybe a satellite view or whatever, have it make sense. And then you're moving troops in certain areas, and then it's an RTS, and there's different games within the game. But yeah, I don't know how difficult that would be to make.
That's kind of how the game that I found on Games Pass, it's called Battle Chasers Night War.
Yeah.
And it's a turn-based game, but what's really cool, it also has dungeon crawler gameplay in it. So like cool. you start on this world, and like it's just you kind of walk around on a map, and then there's like enemy icons, and you go, and that's when like it's really cool. The screen will break, or it'll say like it'll have like three skulls that says battle, and then the screen will break, and then it goes, and you have your three characters. It's awesome. Like I've seen that game 100 hundreds of times, and one day I was just like, you know, fuck it, I'll just download it. I love turn-based games, and you know I'll download it. So I did. So happy I did, because the animation, like, it's 3D. When you're battling, you see it from the side, but it's still your characters are three-dimensional. And then when if you go into you have your regular like world map, and then that's you traverse that, and you can like there's like a city. But when you go into like a like an abandoned like you can go into like exploration areas, and that's where it goes down into like the top view, like a dungeon crawler. Okay. Now your character, like, is you right now I have three characters, and the first the one that I'm using, like when I usually normally use, she has this, you can slam your fist down, and that when you see enemies, you can slam your fist, and that'll give them like some sort of concussion, and that'll transfer over into battle. Or you can use that fist smash for like weak walls and like find secrets. And your other character, he has like a healing ability, and then another one, because there's like traps in like the dungeons. And another one, the other character, you can do this like shadow dash, where you'll dash through the traps. Okay. And you get different characters. So, but it's like that. It's like how you're saying, like, it's kind of a game. You have your turn-based combat, but then you also have the dungeon crawler part. And that's where you see enemies, but like the dungeon crawling, like you can do certain puzzles, small puzzles, and then like you get like materials and stuff like that. They really incorporate it very well, and like the sound and the animations that they have when the turn base, and because that's the whole thing, that's what makes a turn base game. If you ask anybody who loves like Final Fantasy, like the old actual turn base games, if the animations are good, it doesn't matter what turn-based game it is, people will love it. They'll play it. Like, yeah, the fucking animations are great. Yeah. And that's how this is. And the sound is awesome. But yeah, it's really cool. And that's another reason. And cause I grew up on turn-based games. I'm pretty sure I told you that. My brother Josh, you know, they played the Final Fantasy 1, 2, and 3. And then for me, Final Fantasy 3 is the best one. A lot of people say 7. I'm like, yeah, but I really actually like Final Fantasy Tactics, which I watch my brother play. A lot of people don't know about Final Fantasy Tactics, like Dylan and Ricky. Well, I don't know about Ricky, but Dylan, he's so, I'm a Final Fantasy fan. Get the fuck out of here. You don't know shit about Final Fantasy. What's Final Fantasy Tactics?
I never really got into Final Fantasy too much. I remember buying 7 on PlayStation. It came in like that 4-disc.
Yep. Yeah, you open up.
Fucking... Yeah, yeah, yeah. And I looked at it, and I was like, did I buy something that... Well, is too much for me? Yeah, just like what happened?
But yeah, like I said, like back then you didn't need to install every fucking disc.
Yeah, but like it made sense. I remember on the first console, I think it was a 360, you could install games onto your hard drive, and then they wouldn't spin in your console, so you didn't hear it. My console was so quiet because I installed all the games, and I was like, oh, this is a PC. This is where consoles are going. It's you're gonna install the game, put the disc in to recognize it. And then Xbox One was like, oh, you buy the game and you can only use it once, and then your disc is useless. And I'm like, What are you doing? What are you doing? Your fans are going to hate that. What? No. People want more options, not less options, you idiots.
And I'm surprised GameStop is still even a thing.
Oh, no. Oh, GameStop is going to go because they're going more into online. And then they're they have deals to where if a PlayStation or Xbox is bought at their store, they're tied online. So if you go online and then buy a game, GameStop will get a percentage of that through, because that's how they have to survive. Because if you're Xbox and Sony and Nintendo, you want people to buy your console and then buy online, because that's where you make the most profit, because you don't have to make the disc. You don't have to, it's all digital. Yeah. But the only problem is they need GameStop to exist and Walmart and all those places for the hardware, because you can't get consoles out to people. And then that's it. And they say, thank you, I don't need you for any other reason. They want the games too, because that's where most of the money is made. Most consoles are sold at a loss. I was listening to a business podcast, and they said Xbox consoles have always been sold at a loss. And then PlayStation, I think Nintendo, and then I think Sony. There are certain points where they get it to where it's a profit on. But the majority of the console's life cycle, they're sold at a loss, I guess. And where they make the money is off of the games, because the games have a huge
I don't know about this year of fucking Xbox and PlayStation 5. Man, those things sell like fucking hotcakes.
Crazy. They're selling a lot, but if the console costs more to make than you're selling it for, so say like for parts, parts it's $600 or $650, and then they're selling it for $500, or say if it's $550, they're losing $50 or $520 or what, I don't know how each individual part, and then they get manufacturing deals, because if you order more parts, then each part is cheaper. So there's all these different business things to go into.
Technically, they could, if they really wanted to, they could sell these consoles for $1,500.
Well, yeah. But then you wouldn't, there would
no
be
one
less.
Would buy them.
No one would buy, because then you just, you're going into the PC market. So why am I, the whole reason for consoles is you want a self-sustaining video game machine. People that don't care about updating drivers, getting graphics cards, $800, $600 graphics cards. Can I just get a $500 console and then trust you guys to keep making games for it for the next, 6, 7, 8 years? And then we'll buy the next one. And the next one, and the next one, and the next one. So, and then now the consoles are becoming, 60 frames a second, 120 frames. They're getting up there to where PC gaming. It'll never reach that, obviously, because a gaming rig is this big. It's gigantic. Like, and it's cost out, and, you can spend thousands of dollars on it. And a couple $100 console should never be able to compete thousands of dollars. But they're getting there. They're shortening the gap, I would say, because that's what the issue was before with like the Xbox One and the 360 and then the PS4. And now the PS5 is playing games at a good rate. And now with the Xbox Boost, where they're like, hey, all those games that ran at 30 frames a second, they're running at 60 and 120 now, and you don't have to pay for any of it. You don't have to. It's free. We're releasing these games.
Well, they have to be optimized. Remember, they have to be optimized for it.
No. There's like a Boost thing. It's not even optimized. Is a completely different thing. There's like this new Xbox Boost thing that they're doing. There's a list of it online if you want to look at it. It's like Titanfall 2. It's all the Battlefield games now have this Boost. And what it's some weird technology. I don't understand how it works. But it doesn't actually boost the performance of the machine. It takes the frame output that the console is making, say output at 30 frames a second, and it fills in the remaining frames. So like with artificial intelligence or something, and it makes it appear like it's in 60. It's a smooth. So basically you're looking at a 60 frames a second a video, but it's not really native. So it's really interesting.
I wonder if PlayStation does that.
It's like a Xbox thing. And then what Xbox is, they're doing that. So I don't know if PlayStation is going to react, if it becomes a big thing. But it's mostly older games.
Yeah. Because
the newer games run at 60 frames a second usually. It's like 4K 30 or 120 or 1080 60 or whatever, or 4K 60.
Okay. And so
it's never 4K 120 on the console.
No,
not yet, anyway.
No, yeah. So speaking of a little bit of news of Battlefield, Jack Frags that I follow on YouTube, I saw it said Battlefield 6 announcement coming in June.
Okay.
I was a little disappointed that it's not May, because all the other ones were in May.
I heard the end of May, early June. That's what. But who knows? Who knows? But it's, and then there was something funny. What article was that? I saved it, but it was so stupid, because obviously that EA teases Battlefield 6 reveal for June. The next Battlefield game could potentially be released in June, or revealed in June, according to a cheeky tweet from Game's official Twitter account. Battlefield Twitter account says, words that rhyme with soon, June and boom. So that's what the official Battlefield Twitter account said. And then it said something along like, what was it? It was like, the game's going to be released in holiday 2021. And I was like, no shit, they're all released in November. I was like, oh, you guys, thanks for the news article that everybody already knew.
If it was like summer or like fall, I would have like,
yeah, but all Battlefield games released in,
yeah,
October and November.
Just about all the AAA games release at the end of the year. It just gives them more time to polish and do all that.
But it's just, well, it's because Battlefield release dates.
No, yeah, they've all released in like November, October. I think one or two release in October, but most of them are like November.
Yeah, Battlefield 5, November. Battlefield 1, October. So that was the earlier one. Hardline was in March, but do we count that as a Battlefield game? Who knows? Battlefield 4, end of October. Battlefield 3, end of October. Bad Company 2, March. That's the only Battlefield Company 2, yeah. June.
Interesting.
That was 2010. That was a long time. That was a long time ago. People want
the destruction to go either back to Bad Company 2, or anyway, don't get me started. Okay, don't get me started. All right, just don't do it.
I don't know. I think that
everything needs to be destructible. Everything. I don't care. I don't give a fuck. I don't care.
It should just be however you hit the object.
That's usually besides, how it is.
Besides the bomb, but, you know,
whatever. I get what you're saying. Yeah. But yeah, that's so usually just everything. How it is, but yeah, I mean, when it comes to like game mechanics like that, that's where it's destruction and, you know, like stuff like that. That's where I understand that must be incredibly hard to do. They had Red Faction Guerrilla, where they had it like that, like the building would fall like that, like you would.
That was a single player game, wasn't it? I don't know if that was.
No, they had multiplayer on it. They had multiplayer. I mean, obviously not as a scale to Battlefield, but
yeah, you have a huge world.
I still don't understand how you did not like Red Faction Guerrilla. I don't understand how you did not like that game. That is beyond me.
Okay. It was okay. You really like destructibility. Like you get. It turns you on in a weird way.
In a weird way? Hello?
In a very weird way.
Is it not really cool to take a fucking rocket launcher in Battlefield and just shoot the shit out of a wall and see it explode and then you kill someone on the inside?
Well, it's awesome. The coolest thing I think it was Battlefield 3, but they had those huge like concrete section walls, like little vertical walls or whatever, yeah. And I was behind it and I was shooting somebody, and then I saw him pull out an RPG and fired at me, and I was like, holy shit. And I backed up, and then I got the wall right in front of me got hit, and that disintegrated. And it blew up, and then I got knocked back. Your chair is squeaking the shit.
I need to get a new one. Sorry. Go ahead.
Or just some WD-40. But then, so I get knocked back, and you fall on the ground, and I see where the concrete thing was, and it's completely gone. And I'm just, that's a moment you don't get in most games, because that's like a dynamic thing. It's not a cutscene.
Yeah.
Not, you know, scripted. It's just something that happened. That kind of thing would be even more cool if it was just a chunk of it was gone or whatever, or wherever that was hit, just took off. Yeah, so I was like,
well, RPG, that would probably do the whole thing.
Yeah, well, like the bottom stub part was still there, but it depends. Well, yeah, depending on the explosion and stuff. But like the destructibility in, say, like Rainbow Six Siege, where you just put the explosive on the wall and then boom, and then just that part of the wall is gone, so you can make your own, you know, ways into rooms and stuff. Like, that is unbelievable. I don't know, even though on a large scale, it'd be crazy.
Even though they did kind of lie on the when they first revealed Rainbow Six Siege, they fibbed a good amount with the destruction, because they showed where you could just put a, you know, an explosive trap on any part of the floor and it'll explode, and that's fine. Nope, there's only specific parts, and I'm like, you fucking, I swear to, if you're look. That's why there's, for Battlefield, there's so many fans, is because for the most part, I'd say about 90% of destruction is wherever you shoot, that's where it's going to happen. You don't need a specific, you know, now obviously, yeah, they have like there's parts that are static, you know, objects in the world. But, or for instance, like, because I played Rainbow Six Siege, it was like a month ago, and like, I remember like, I shot it was an explosion, and then the ground, like, I was on a second story, and then you see slats or bars in the ground.
Yeah.
It's not like full destructibility. I'm like, okay, all right, well.
Well, there should be things that are like in a game like that where you're infiltrating a house, like you don't want it to be where they can just destroy the house.
Well, like no, that. Of course
like
not.
When it's just one thing or whatever, or a level,
but,
or
well, of course not. Well, like, but what the whole thing is because in a close quarters like that, you're not gonna have RPGs. That's the whole thing. You might have like explosives, but you're limited to how many explosives you have as well. And like the only thing that's really some inner walls are or have like micro destruction, but they're really the only things that are fully destructible. Are the boards and the windows, like even the walls, like you can't just, I mean, as far as I remember, you can't just go like right next to like a window that's destructible and there's a wall and then place something on the wall and then detonate it. I mean, you can like on the inner walls, but it's not every single wall. And I don't know. It's still cool. Like I get it. Like it's still, you know, really cool, but
I just think it's a step. It's a step in that direction.
Yeah.
And with how popular that game is, still years and years later, it would behoove of somebody to make more games like that. People want realistic tactical shooters that are realistic. I don't want to play a Fortnite game where I'm building walls all around me and shooting somebody. That seems so dumb. It just seems so dumb. And I play a cartoon pirate game most of the time, and that seems dumb to me. Like, what is the purpose of building? I don't understand. So it's a deathmatch game where you can build stuff. You can build forts.
Well, it's actually, the game started out as just a PvE.
Yeah, something else. Yeah, it started out as something completely different. And then it became PvE. Something else. Yeah,
and then they introduced Battle Royale to it, and then it fucking took off.
But I still don't understand what the point of, it's like, people are good players because they can build quickly or build well.
Yo, yeah, of course.
So I like the, you don't have to be good at running and gunning. I like the different aspects, different types of playing. How I enjoy to play in Battlefield is like you and Dylan go spray everything, and then I'm a support character. I like doing that kind of stuff. That stuff is fun because then I get to watch the battle, a part of the battle, and see all the cool shit going on. I'm like, ooh, that's cool. He came from this way, you know, whatever. The smoke came over here. You can't see. And then that part of it is cool to me. But in Fortnite, it just looks silly.
Of course.
It just looks weird. I don't know.
Yeah, and that's the problem too. Is like,
I don't get the connection. You have these.
I mean, I played it. Like, you know, it can be fun. Like, it's definitely different. But I don't. You know, I don't really take it seriously, really at all. I'm just like, okay, you guys want to play Fortnite? Okay, sure. But I'm not like, hey, I'm playing Fortnite today. We're gonna play hours of Fortnite. No. But it's another problem though is with building like that is. A lot of, you know, they say a lot of these Timmies and Tommies, like those little fucking like 6-year-olds, that's what they say.
Yeah.
It's kind of funny. Or like you say, hey guys, what's going on, man? Like, come on. But like they can't play regular games like Battlefield. They get fucking destroyed, or Call of Duty, because they can't place a wall right in front of them. So they become so reliant on that. Yeah.
It's not like Battlefield where you have to bring out, you have to like switch to a different mode and then build something. Because if somebody catches you building something, you're like,
you're dead.
You're completely dead.
And yeah, and they can destroy whatever you build within seconds if they have, you know, if they have the right tools.
Yeah. So
that's one thing that I love about Battlefield, and I mean, I've always known about it, but it was just I played it for a little bit the other day, and I had built these sandbags up, and someone had shot a rocket. Now, what's really cool too is what I forgot is if you have an LMG and you continuously shoot sandbags, you'll break the sandbags down with the LMG.
Oh, that's cool.
I'm like, but they shot an RPG and it hit the sandbag, but it didn't destroy the entire sandbag. Like, there were still parts of it left. I'm like, see that right there, man. Just like little things like that, I tell you.
It keeps people playing because it's new stuff. It just, there's like layers of the gameplay. It's not just the same thing every time. You build a wall, then you shoot the wall, then the whole wall disappears. It's like, I don't know, layered, obviously. You have to do not watch the whenever the Battlefield trailer comes out. You cannot watch it without recording yourself.
All right. Well, we should just watch it while we're on stream.
I'm wondering, because it could come out when you're at work, and then you're not going to be able to control yourself, and you're just going to watch it. I know how you are.
No. I'll promise. I'll.
You promise?
Yeah.
Okay.
We might have to have an emergency podcast the next day.
Well, that's fine. We can come on here and just watch you watch it. I want to see your dumb reaction, and then we can go through the video and then break everything down and do all that stuff. I think you'll. It's not very often when a new Battlefield game comes out.
Well, yeah, I know. Especially since they were smart about it and said, hey, give them an extra year.
They wait. It's fine. Have Battlefield every 3-4 years. It's fine.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, exactly. But did you get my text this morning?
No.
It was really early.
God, you said not that jerk. I remember. I probably got it, but ignored it once I saw it was you. The movies. Yeah. That Jason Statham. Yeah, if there's a movie theater, we can go, or whatever. I don't know what that has to do with video games. But you just want to
see. No, I'm asking about it. But what else? What else are we gonna do this weekend, sir? Is there anything that you've been wanting to
do? I have to. I don't know if there's a fight this weekend. I don't think so. But we'll figure something out. I don't know if the Padres are in town. We can maybe go to a baseball game.
Ooh, I've never been to a baseball game before.
Yeah, I have to figure it out because there's one. I tried to buy something from Ticketmaster for June, and it said I needed a COVID vaccine or a test, but then I haven't gotten a tip. I don't know if it's just Ticketmaster that needs that, or if like you go to the stadium, and then they have. I don't know how that works. So I want to make sure if I buy a ticket and then I go. And then they're like, do you have a COVID proof of COVID test or whatever? But that doesn't make any sense because I could have a COVID test 6 months ago.
Yeah.
And that, so it would have to be a recent COVID test within what? And then even if it's 24 hours, the last 24 hours, I could still run into somebody. It's between that test, that negative test, and now. And so it doesn't, to me, the park is spaced out anyway.
Well, and then, yeah, and also, I never remember. I think you and I agreed. I don't really trust the COVID tests. I don't trust them. And she got a COVID test. She got it. It said that she was positive with abnormalities. I don't even know what the fuck that means. She got it again like a week, maybe a half a week or a week later. Said she was negative. I'm like, okay. You motherfuckers, man. Like,
well,
what
I know
are
there's
you
different.
Serious?
I know there's different types of tests. And it's all about like the viral load or whatever. But like the abnormalities, she could have had it, say, and then the pieces that it picks up could have been waning off and they don't, the percentage wasn't high. It was like a low percentage. It could be, but I don't, you'd have to talk to a doctor. Like how can, what does that even mean? Like to us it doesn't make sense. It's going to seem weird.
It's us knowing that it is a fact that the hospitals would get more money per COVID case and test. They would get a certain amount of money. Knowing that,
that just incentivizes everything to
like,
COVID.
What is stopping them from lying? Like there have been reports of people who, like last year when I went to Lake Mead with Jake and his family, he had a friend who said that one of his friends had gotten sent a COVID test in the mail just randomly, and then he didn't take it. He didn't send it in. And then, like, a week later, he got a positive test in the week or in the mail. He's like, I didn't take the test, though.
Well, that could be some kind of scam. I don't know if that.
Well, of course. But, I mean, it's still, even then, you're just like, really?
I don't know. I don't know. It's weird, but like, but in my head, like, if you want proof of the vaccine, that makes sense to me. But if you don't, but you obviously can't. I don't know if it's illegal to refuse service because. But then aren't there schools that if you have to have certain vaccines for children?
Well, see. They don't need it because the children we know as science is they say to follow the science, which they don't themselves. Children are really not affected by COVID, really at all.
Well, yeah, but I'm wondering because since the so what percentage, like in my head, I'm thinking as far as you got to go soon, but
no, it's, yeah, you're good.
As far as like forcing people to have the vaccine in order to do, I don't know, normal stuff, go to movies, go all those things. But we had to have vaccines for certain things before. But those things were, if I remember correctly, more deadly.
Yes.
So, yes. And then, so if things are more deadly, what percentage is the threshold? Mm-hmm. That's where it gets weird.
I know.
Just in general. Because when you say like 500,000 people died of COVID, you're like, holy shit, that's a lot. But then you look into how many people there are in this country. There's 350 million, 300 yeah. something million, and then there was 32 million positive COVID cases. And then so, like, that number is very, very small. It's less than a percent. So if it's less – so what is the threshold? Is it one?
And it could even be less.
Is it 10?
Well, like, yeah.
I don't know.
And those deaths could be – because we know for a fact that places were saying, you know, people died of a heart attack. But putting on their death certificate, they died of COVID. Same thing with people dying of
cars. Because they had COVID, yeah.
Yeah, and I'm like, so that you're lying. You're lying to get more money. That's another reason why I don't trust the tests. I don't. Sorry, I'm not gonna.
Like the tests. I don't know if the tests are the issue. I think it's the people that are incentivized because during the whole crazy rush, hospitals. The normal patients or whatever were kind of put on, they had so much influx of COVID people that's all they were kind of seeing. That's all they had like power for. Like everything else was kind of being pushed aside if it wasn't an emergency. So I can see them kind of trying to like, hey, how are we going to make ends meet? Well, the government's giving us more money if, you know, if all these things are COVID, which is, and then like, it's like record numbers low in the flu. So I'm like, how is the flu less contagious right now unless COVID kills the flu or combines with it? I don't know. I don't know how that works. But I'm just like, this is interesting.
There's a lot. There's a lot of questions where you're just like, okay, well, that doesn't make any sense though. And if you
– It doesn't make sense to my uneducated brain. I'm just like,
how? You don't need to be completely educated to ask normal, logical questions.
No, I can ask questions. Yeah, I'm not an idiot for – like, I don't think any – well, there's no such thing as a stupid question. But there is technically. It's like, there's a basketball bounce. It's like, well, if it has air in it, yeah. Like, that's a stupid question. What? But it's just these logical things. At least what I think is logical in my head. I'm like, well, why is the flu down? Is it because we're socially distancing? Is it because people are wearing masks? I don't know. But then COVID is spiking through the roof. So then our social distancing shouldn't be working unless the flu is – this is way more contagious than the flu, apparently. So I'm just wondering, are we mixing up like COVID positive tests and the flu positive tests? Like,
but then I think
I don't know because it's like a variant of the flu.
I want to say in 2019. Now you have to look it up in 2019. I think there was like 60,000 people that died of pneumonia in 2019, but we don't have any lockdowns for that. 60,000 people—that's a fucking shit ton.
Yeah,
but like you said, where's the threshold?
I don't know what the percentages were. It was like, but if like 5% of kids were dying, I'd be like, okay, we need, but and then it's like 70 something percent of people who died of COVID were also obese. Mm-hmm. So in my head, I'm thinking if you can help that, like, I don't know. It's a weird road. It's a weird road to go down to where you're like, when are you personally responsible for your own health? And then, so because, say I'm fat, I have some core morbidities, even if I can't help it. Say I cannot help being fat. Say if I eat lettuce and I'm 300 pounds. My deficiency, I shouldn't put my deficiency on other people.
Yeah.
Like the rest of the majority, the 99.9% of people shouldn't have to alter their entire lives because I unfortunately have an issue. Like you should want to include people like me in everyday stuff, but it's, but you like when you go to a movie theater, they don't have the movie in subtitles for people who are deaf. How can deaf people go to movies? They can't. So what?
Because the majority of people aren't deaf.
Yeah. So I'm just like, where it gets this weird, like, where is that, like, again, that threshold to where, okay, we have to change society a little. We have to change and we have to make it acceptable for this small group of people. So I don't know. It's just like, there are people who are allergic to mushrooms. So do restaurants not have mushrooms? No, you have to take the responsibility to say, hey, I'm allergic to mushrooms. Make sure you don't use any mushroom oil, whatever. I don't know.
That's the whole problem. That's why I don't understand how this transgender bullshit, oh, we have to change the bathrooms now. It's like the population of transgender is like 0.1 or even 0.01%. And most of them are acting. They're acting. It's not real. They don't actually have a problem. They don't have a mental problem. They're just acting so they can get famous. That's literally all it is.
But yeah, because you get so much clout. It's like when people faked the Jesse Smollett, he faked the racial attack just to get clout or whatever. And
he's trying to get more famous.
Yeah, people are like, well, people don't do that. It's like, there's an incentive for everything. Like people play victim just to get it all. And then that actually hurts the people who are actual victims and actually have those issues. But like, but with the bathrooms, like just make them all gender neutral, whatever. Just have like one toilet and then one person goes in and goes to the bathroom. That's not hard. I've been to restaurants where they have a boys and a girls bathroom and they only have one toilet in each one. So one girl goes in, closes the door behind her, locks it.
Oh, yeah.
Goes to the bathroom and then leaves. So it doesn't matter. And I've been at bars to where the guy's bathroom, there's a line, and the woman's bathroom, there's no one using it because I'm at a bar, there's mostly dudes there. So I just went in the woman's bathroom. I was like, I'm not going to wait in this five people in line. I was like, what are we doing here? This is silly that I can't go into a room and use a toilet. There's no other women in there. There's no. And I remember once I accidentally, it was the weirdest feeling ever. I was at a movie theater in Apple Valley and I walked into the women's bathroom and I didn't realize. I don't know what happened. I wasn't drinking. I don't know if I got hit in the head earlier in the day, but I walked in, I was peeing. Nobody was in there. Nobody. And then all of a sudden I hear all these women like just come in the bathroom all at once. And I'm just like, I had this everything felt, I got really hot and then really cold all at once. I was just like, what am I doing? And I was like, oh, wait a minute. This is ridiculous. So I walked out and I was like, sorry, wrong. I honestly didn't know. And I just walked out. I didn't wash my hands. So I just got out of there as quickly as possible. I was like,
probably laughed.
I don't know, but like one of the women are like, I was like, I thought this was the men's. Nobody was in
my left and right. I don't know.
I'm sorry. I came around the corner and it was just in restrooms. And then I just took the right. I took the real quick right. There's a door. I pushed it open and I felt really weird. I was like, I don't belong in here. I don't belong in here. This isn't my bathroom. I didn't even realize there were no stand-up urinals.
That's a social construct. Okay. Yeah. We have those for a reason. Okay. Yeah. Do us all a favor. Jump off the highest cliff into some water.
Please.
Or just go do labor work and you'll have nothing to worry about.
Yeah. They say there's no difference in gender until the jobs that they want, like the highly coveted jobs. They don't want to be construction workers. No. They don't want to be all those other things. You know?
Electric workers. No, of course not.
Yeah. They don't want to be plumbers. That's just, you don't have, what about those male dominated work? Those jobs. Oh, you just want you want to be a doctor or an actress or, okay. You want to be
a model. You want to go on Twitch and
got it. Yeah.
And you heard about that? Never mind. It's already 4:37. We'll talk about that next
time. But there's no discrepancy in, like TikTok. Why don't the the female influencers on TikTok get paid more. Female strippers get paid more. Female prostitutes get paid more. What about those discrepancies? Oh,
yeah. Okay. And you know how easy it is to get famous on Twitch if you just show a little bit of cleavage, or like what I was gonna say is they
how
like
much easier it is
because of like spring's coming, dude. There was like an influx of female Twitch streamers, being in because like the rules are is you can be in a bathing suit as long as you're near a body of water. So they would just feel like a little tub. And they just be in these skimpiest song bikinis with their asses out, getting thousands of views, and they just started Twitch last fucking week. I'm like, dude, are you kidding me? That's insane. I would do it. I would do it.
If I was a cute girl, I would go. Yeah, I would make a living off of Twitch and getting donations. I'd get like maybe a little boob job, little tuck here or there, and then just. If you like video games and you're a cute girl and you can play them and make money off of, you know, your personality and your looks, go ahead and do it. If dudes want to pay for that, let them do it. But anyways,
they're always gonna do it. All right.
Always. Men are always gonna be dumb. This has been another episode of the Video Games and Nonsense Podcast. I'm Chase Carter. That's
Raymond Woods.
We appreciate you guys for watching, and we'll talk to you next week.
Yeah.
I remember